Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to the Q1 FY22 earnings conference call of Allcargo Logistics, hosted by PhillipCapital India Private Limited. This conference call may contain forward-looking statements about the company, which are based on the beliefs, opinions, and expectations of the company as on date of this call. These statements are not the guarantees of future performance and involve risks and uncertainties that are difficult to predict. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions when the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Vikram Suryavanshi from PhillipCapital India Private Limited. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Yeah, hi. Good evening, everyone. And thank you for being on the call of Allcargo Logistics. We are happy to have with us the management of Allcargo for Q&A session with the investment community. From the management, we have with us Mr. Suresh Kumar R, CEO, India Office or India Business. Mr. Tim Tudor, CEO, EQ Worldwide, Mr. Ravi Jakar, Chief Strategy Officer, and Mr. Deepal Shah, Chief Financial Officer. Now, I hand over call to Mr. Ravi for their opening comments, and then we will have question and answer session. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, thanks, Vikram. Good evening, everyone, and good morning to some of your friends from US. Welcome to the earnings conference call to discuss the performance for our first quarter of FY22. I trust all of you and your dear ones and colleagues and everyone at home is keeping safe in these challenging times. I also hope you had a chance to look at our results and the earnings presentation, which has been uploaded on the exchanges and the company website. We have had some challenging times given the second wave of pandemic in India. And with our experience and transformational initiatives which have been initiated over the last 12 to 15 months, we as a company across businesses have been able to continue the momentum which was built, and it has rather gathered pace as we enter FY22. And we remain much more confident in building up from here through multiple transformation programs going on to drive growth and keep the business performance significantly strong. To begin with, let's run through some of the financial highlights, and to take you through them, I would request my colleague Deepal to share brief highlights on the financial performance for the quarter. Over to you, Deepal.
Thank you, Ravi. Let me first take you through the key consolidated financial highlights for the first quarter of FY22. The total consolidated revenue from operations stood at 3,449 crores as compared to 2,078 crores for the corresponding period last year, which is an increase of 66%. EBITDA excluding other income for the quarter was at 217 crores as against 131 crores during the corresponding period last year, which is an increase of 66%. EBITDA margins stood flat at 6.3 YOY. Profit before tax, before exceptional items, and profit from associates grew by 3.5x to its highest level since 2021 at 125 crores. Reported profit after tax stood at 106 crores for the quarter, which includes exceptional gains and profits from associates and JVs. Exceptional gains are largely pertaining to profit on sale of land to the extent of 11 crores and recording of the CFS revenues of prior year established by court order. Now I would like to hand over the call back to Ravi to take you through the key business segment highlights and key updates for the quarter.
Thank you, Deepal. Coming to business updates during the quarter, we have had some exciting times driving organic growth as well as building on our expansion aspirations with some strategic acquisitions. As we have been highlighting over our past calls as well, at Allcargo, our focus is on being asset-light being ROCE focused, and we are extremely focused on being growth oriented, and we focus on businesses which can be driven with digital enablement. And therefore, the focus has largely been on the core businesses, which is multimodal transport operations or the ocean freight business operating under the EQ Worldwide business, the container freight station business, and the express and contract logistics business, which operates under Gati and Avasha CCI. We have great confidence in the growth in trade in the country, and therefore we continue to remain very focused on growing the CFS ICT business. In this regard, we have also announced acquisition of 85% controlling stake in Speedy Multimodes, which gives us an access to two additional CFSs with very strategic asset capabilities and a good business at the largest container ports of Mundra and JNPT, which will provide great strategic impetus to our growth plan and allow us to consolidate our market leadership position in the CFS business in the country. So to first of all, to begin with the India businesses, besides CFS and ICD, to also share updates on the other businesses, I would request my colleague Suresh to share further updates on the strategic intent in the acquisition of Speedy Multimodes, and also to share the highlights on key business developments and the performance for the quarter. Over to you, Suresh.
Thank you, Ravi. Good evening to the participants in this part of the world in India, and good morning, good afternoon to the others. It is the first time I have the opportunity to interact with you. It is a privilege for me. I'm talking to you even as in the country the pandemic second wave is waning. And all of us know it has brought in new dimensions to our business as in every other industry. And we look forward to continue contributing to the Indian economy in a strong way and participate in the next chapter of the India growth story. We certainly believe India's favorable demographic, geographic, and regulatory positions helps us to continue the growth story and be the fastest growth country in the pack of developing nations. All Cargo India business would like to ride the wave and achieve newer milestones in the period to come. I would first talk to some of the highlights of the businesses and then talk to you about Speedy Multimodes, like my colleague Ravi had spoken. So Q1 FY22, some of the highlights in our CFS and ICD business. We exited Q4 with our highest ever volume. And in Q1, there was a little slowdown triggered by the second wave of COVID. At 2.75 million TEUs, major Indian port volumes registered a QOQ degrowth of about 7 to 7.5%, with Mundra and Pipavav declining at a much faster rate. Our volume degrew by about 10 to 10.5% from the previous quarter high of 92,000 TEUs to about 82,465. If we look at it versus the previous year, we had a 1.7x growth. In that, we know that the last year AMJ quarter was the first wave of lockdown. So that quarter had a drop in volumes, but increase in revenues due to ground rentals, which I will take you through when we talk about revenues, which is 122 crores in this quarter versus the 128 crores for the corresponding period last year. It's a 4% reduction, and ground rental accrual is what causes that difference. The EBIT for the quarter was 34 crores, as against 51 crores for the corresponding previous period, lower by 33%, and the EBIT margins stood at 28%. The decline in profitability is also directly linked to the ground rent accruals that we received in the same period last year. The annualized ROCE, which is a thing that we constantly focus on, like what Ravi said, for the segment remains healthy at 34%. In the CFS ICD business highlights for the first quarter, I will take you through the logistics park business next, where our total revenue for the quarter stood at a quarterly run rate of 21 crores as against 9 crores for the corresponding period last year. Our reported EBIT stood at 6 crores for the quarter. Blackstone covers our logistics park across the states of Karnataka, Haryana, Goa, Hyderabad, and some parts of the Jhajjar warehousing, which post the deal would be 90% held by Blackstone and 10% by All Cargo Logistics. The construction costs funded by the company continues to be repaid by way of refinancing through lease rental discounting facilities that are well served by the rental that we receive. Post the completion of the deal, All Cargo endeavors to reduce the debt on consolidated books considerably by the end of FY22. The transaction has seen some delays due to COVID impact of working on various offices, especially the approving authorities. However, major approvals in place, construction and development work is now at progressing steadily. That's with our logistics park business. A quick update to you about our projects and engineering solutions. And here we see a slight difference of the impact of the pandemic, as we see the total revenue for the quarter stood at 94 crores versus 64 crores for the corresponding period last year, which was marked by a lot of lockdown. So it is a 47% year-on-year growth that we have. The utilization levels have steadily improved from the low levels of 42% last year, same period, to over 75%. Our strategy to trim down loss-making and low-yield assets are steadily aiding EBIT improvement. The losses in the segment narrowed to 12 crores for the quarter. ROCEs remain stretched due to significant depreciation on equipment. However, the project logistics order book remains healthy at Rs. 1.8 billion. Focus on infrastructure growth and development of new metro and renewable power projects is likely to provide good opportunities in the near future. So this brings to an end the highlights on the three business segments in India. I would like to quickly talk to you about speedy multi-mode acquisition that we are planning. This is a CFS facility in Navasheva that we are evaluating, and this adds to the presence that we already have with the All Cargo CFS. In a highly fragmented market, this gives us many advantages and builds on the asset-light ROC focus and the digital enablement plans that we have overall for the group. Strategically located closer to the port, in fact, the speedy multi-mode CFS facility is closest to the port, and with a complementary set of customers and with a higher percentage of business coming in from export, this business fits in very well with the position we have and will help us grow market shares to the levels of 15% and more that we would like to have in the CFS portion. 15% in excess would also make us the largest CFS in the JNPT Navasheva area, and that is also an added incentive for us to be looking at this acquisition favorably. With that, I come to an end of my portion, and I'll request Ravi to explain certain developments in our global MTO business. Over to you, Ravi.
Yeah, thank you, Suresh. Let me now talk briefly about our MTO division, which is largely the ocean freight business operating under the EQ Worldwide setup. As we announced recently, we have acquired a 65% stake in Nauticon, which is the market leader and commands significant 40% of the neutral consolidation market in the Nordic region, which is Sweden, Norway, Finland, and Denmark. This acquisition has allowed us to continue on our growth path of expanding our presence across the globe and bringing in a strong player like Nauticon would help us reach our strategic goals of further strengthening our market leadership. The business segment continues to perform well for us on the back of transformation, and to provide more information on the transaction as well as on the key highlights for how the business has been operating, I request my colleague and the CEO for EQ Worldwide, Tim Tudor, to share brief insights with you. Tim, over to you.
Yes, thank you, Ravi, and hi all. It's a pleasure of mine to be with you for the first time for me. It gives me great honor to be on this call. A little bit more color on the Nordicon deal, because it's very exciting for us, indeed. It fills a white space for us where we had the availability to improve our market presence in the region. And this partnership brings together two real leaders, ourselves and Nordicon, in the fast-growing global LCL segment, which creates a better platform to grow both ocean LCL and FCL businesses, as well as rail freight from China across to Europe, which we have a significant market share in that as well. Nordicon itself holds a 40% market share in the region for the ocean freight consolidation, and the deal is really a fantastic entry for us into the new geography, where we will continue to build our global strength in the region. The partnership will give freight forwarders and other clients a much required flexible and time-bound logistics solutions into the Nordic region. It's not just two market leaders, I should say. We will be leveraging the geographic presence of both ourselves and Nordicon, as well as also leverage our technological capabilities, providing customers the ease of transaction. Nordicon will continue to use its existing customer service platform, which they call MyNordicon, and we'll integrate it into ours, which we call ECU360, and we will run a truly global tech network. Let me run you through some of the key highlights with us in regards to the MTO business, which is operated under the global brand of ECU Worldwide. Total revenue for the quarter stood at 2,935 crore, as against 1,737 crore for the corresponding period last year, an increase of about 69%. With year on year would not be the right comparison, as we have maintained the growth momentum quarter on quarter as well, which grew by 8%. Volumes year on year are up roughly 20% for the LCL and 30% for the FCL. Those volume growths are on top of the lockdowns from the pandemic from the previous year. But it's interesting to note that our growth is actually now, when we compare against 2019, we're outperforming the performance of 2019, which is important to note prior to the pandemic. EBIT stood at 136 crore against 79 crore for the corresponding period last year, an increase of 72%. And improved profitability at a similar asset-based result on return on capital employed improved to its highest level of 36%. Contributing to these results, of course, is, as you mentioned, the transformation projects that we have underway inside the organization. We have a lot of transformation work streams happening. Among them, we have sales acceleration and cost optimization and other long-term driving plans that will continue to drive both growth and cost maintenance down the line. We are also participating right now in a very buoyant ocean shipping global environment, which is leading to higher volumes and higher margins. And this trend should continue through the end of Q4 for us and into the beginning of the 2023 reporting year. We're also extremely focused on technology and digitalization, which is key for logistics providers across the globe. We are leading the market with a product called ECU360, which, as I mentioned before, with our new acquisition, will tie into MyNordicon. But on a global perspective, it is by far the market leader for LCL transactions for ocean freight. I think that covers it, Ravi. So back over to you to continue the updates. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thanks, Tim. Commenting on the express and contract logistics businesses that we operate through our subsidiaries Gati and ACCI. Gati's performance in quarter one was impacted by the second wave of COVID. However, revenue for the quarter adjusted for the Gati cost of divestment still stood at 298 crores as against 164 crores for the first quarter in the same period previous year, which was hit by an even more significant early impactful first wave. However, we have seen that The trend had already started to improve towards the end of the quarter, and it has continued to sustain the improvement as the economy is getting back and trade and logistics is opening up. So as we speak, we already see that the business has revived to its normal or almost near normal levels. The transformation exercise continues to gain momentum, and we are on track for achieving the sustainable growth targets that we've been speaking about. And we are happy that the transformation program across operations, sales, and even digital enablement has been working well. Particularly on the digital implementation, our WhatsApp chatbot, Genie, which was launched, has been very successful and is has seen significant adaptability in the market and very strong customer satisfaction scores. Our digital cash collection initiatives have also been very successful, with now already more than 30% of cash transactions collected digitally, and this would continue to go up. We also have the privilege of welcoming Phil as the CEO for Gati, and under his leadership, we believe that Gati would continue to gain momentum from here on and drive growth. On the contract logistics business, which is under ACCI, along with the CCFF business, also witnessed strong growth despite the pandemic and the challenging environment. ACCI registered a year-on-year growth of 150% and 32% growth quarter-on-quarter. The growth was largely driven by the continued momentum in the e-commerce, as well as strong performance in chemical vertical, which is the core and where we're the market leaders as well. We have also been running the transformation program. And I would also like to highlight that in the ACCI, we're also trying to bring in sharp business focus on growth segment of contract logistics. And therefore, we have filed for a scheme of demerger by which the ACCI business would be demerged, wherein the contract logistics business would get transferred to Avashya Supply Chain, which currently is a wholly owned subsidiary of All Cargo, would be the vehicle for demerger, and the CCFA business would remain under ACCI. This, of course, is subject to the due process being followed, but the demerger scheme has been initiated. This will allow the business to have stronger focus on the high-growth contract logistics segment. So with this, I would like to express that the business performance continues to remain strong across all business segments. And particularly in India, now we see that the economic activity is back and the business continues to be at normal levels and driven towards strong growth on the back of transformation. That is all from our side. Thank you very much. And now I would like to open the floor to any questions that you may have. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on the touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue is set. Participants who wish to ask a question, please press star and one now. The first question is from the line of Keshav Garg from PCIPL. Please go ahead.
So wanted to understand that this CD multi-modes are what kind of profitability does this company enjoy?
Yeah, so basically Speedy multi-modes is has two CFSs, one in JNPT and one in Mundra. In the period of FY21, the company has registered a revenue of approximately 188 crores, and it has an EBITDA of approximately 25 to 30 crores. That's the range you would like to share. And we believe that with the acquisition by us, we see some opportunities to transform the operations and also improve the operating margin. So we believe that this transaction can be highly value accretive for us.
Yeah, so we'll be taking over some debt also of this company?
No, there is no significant debt in the company.
So that's great that we are paying 102 crore to acquire a company with 25-30 crore of EBITDA. And so that's very good news.
Yeah, so we are acquiring 85% share in the company at an enterprise valuation of 120 crores. And it would certainly be value accretive. And like I said, the company currently has CFS operations, and it's an asset-light facility, which it means that it has contracts to operate the CFS on these facilities. One of the contracts has an extension due in 2026, and the other one has more than 25 years of the lease period left. So we also believe that those automatic renewals, which are subject to satisfactory operations, would all be taken care of with our efficient management. And certainly, there are opportunities to really drive strong performance, and therefore, it can be very highly value-creative, particularly if you look at the capital that we're employing towards acquiring these and the returns that it can generate for us. So yes, we do expect this to also add strong volumes, and like my colleague Suresh mentioned earlier, also a very interesting mix of the new set of customers and also the contribution from export side.
So that's great news. And sir, coming to our MTO business, sir, so this quarter on consolidated basis, we did 136 crore of PBIT, so which is significant improvement year on year. So you think that this level on a quarterly run rate, 136 crore or thereabouts, is sustainable?
So I would say that, you know, the performance is driven by a combination of various factors. There is a volume growth which is driving it. There's a transformational initiative which is helping us to not just grow sales but also optimize costs. And there indeed has been some contribution through favorable environment, as my colleague Tim spoke about, with a combination of all factors. But as we foresee, the transformation initiatives will gain momentum and continue to have deeper impact. So these performance levels are indeed sustainable.
So that's again very encouraging. And so lastly, coming to our project and engineering solutions, so the losses have reduced quite substantially. And if the trend is anything to go by, it seems that in very near, this segment will break even. So you think that we are on line to break even?
So we have continued to look at rationalizing the fleet in the project and equipment business, and which is allowing us to also focus on utilization. So therefore, the profits have been going up, and at the same time, we are trying to bring down the asset base as well, which leads to a higher depreciation, which largely is the reason causing a negative EBIT. If you look at the EBITDA level, the business has been providing strong cash flows. So it's not like a business which is draining cash from the company. It's been contributing cash flows, but because of straight line depreciation over the asset life, which is longer in reality as compared to what it is in books, it appears that way. So yes, as we move forward, the losses should continue to narrow down at EBIT level. But I would like to reiterate that these losses are not at the EBITDA level. At EBITDA level, the business continues to contribute strong cash flows.
And sir, I wanted to just say that the reason for the delisting was that the market was not giving good value to our share, but today the share price crossed its previous all-time high. So I think, sir, that problem is behind us. So if you can convey this message to our promoters, then that would be great.
We will certainly convey our message to the promoters. And as you rightly pointed out, delisting is a matter between public shareholders and promoters. From the company's perspective, I can provide updates to you on the process and also for the benefit of all other participants. Since the regulations changed while the process was ongoing, the process had to be reinitiated under the new delisting regulations. And therefore, It is currently under the shareholder approval, so it has come back to shareholders for approval, and therefore, considering that the voting that counts is only for public shareholders, therefore the decision on delisting would be dependent upon what the public shareholders decide for the delisting process to continue, and therefore not really in the hands of the promoters as well at this point in time. And this is the decision of the public shareholders by way of voting, which is going on at this point in time, approximately between 10th to 15th September, as the postal ballot window closes, the company would be in a position to share updates on what happens in that process.
Okay, so thank you very much and best of luck.
Thank you. Participants who wishes to ask a question, please press star and one now. The next question is from the line of Prateek Kumar from Antique Stock Broking. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good evening, everyone. My question is to sir. So basically, business in MTO segment has been now got significant tailwind from the business environment. I think this, after a while, we are seeing this kind of profits coming in this segment. So how do you think? First of all, what is your view on the freight rates globally? How do you think recent close down of port in China have had any impact on the freight rates? And generally, how does this strong freight environment, like let's say, while no one knows, but let's say next year, if this freight rates like sort of normalizes significantly, would that impact our margins also on per TU or on percentage margin basis? So these are my related questions on MTO segment.
Yeah, Tim, if you could answer these questions.
Yeah, sure, absolutely. So there is continual disruption to the industry with the port closures, right? We now have Ningbo moving into some lockdown of some sort, but it's not the entire all the multiple terminals within the Ningbo area. There are different terminals spread across different entry waterways. So there's one terminal in particular that's been closed, and yes, it does provide some disruption to the business, and these kind of activities will continue to do so, as we have learned with the Suez Canal blockage and what have you. But in addition to that, there continues to be very strong demand for freight movement and continual container shortages, where you can't get empty containers. So the upsurge in cargo, along with the disruption that happens in the industry, are going to continue to keep the freight rates high. Now, will they stay as high as they are forever? No. Will they stay high as they are now for, let's call it, the foreseeable future, if we go out 6 months? Yes, I believe so, and that'll move around trade lane by trade lane, or cluster trade lanes by cluster trade lanes. And then at some point, the rates will retreat again, but they will not come back to the levels they were at previously. As an example, if a container freight rate from a China-based port to European-based port was at $2,000, I'm going to speak in dollars for a 40-foot container, and then it went up to $12,000. It won't come back down to two. It'll settle at five or six, or some. The normalized rate will be a much higher rate level than it was before. So that could erode a little bit of the margin going down the line, but it won't be as much as it was before. I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, thanks for answering them. Like most of them, like got answered. My second question is on we paid like 120 crores for 30 crore kind of EBITDA business. So is this how much do we see like accretion in this property of this particular CFS? And I remember vaguely that this particular CFS was also handling a lot of DPD volumes when this whole noise around DPD started. So is it something that which gives a significant advantage versus peers?
So on the DPD side, you know, just to share with you, currently almost 20 plus CFSs handle DPD. So there's no technical differentiation. However, as my colleague Suresh mentioned, this is the closest CFS to JNPT, and therefore logistically, it's most convenient and most efficient to use the CFS, and therefore it has continued to perform well. And we believe that with our participation in managing, we should be in a position to further strengthen the CFS. So therefore, it is likely to continue to exhibit strong performance and will contribute to our growth.
And is it something which was very aggressively bidded, or only like this was one-on-one transaction between the two parties?
No, this was a one-on-one transaction between the two parties. There are, so like I said, this is not owned land. This is the Speedy Multimodes has rights to operate these CFSs in Mundra and JNPT for a fixed period of time, which is subject to renewal. And that is where we believe that with us coming in, there'll be an opportunity to continue to sustain the volumes, exhibit strong operational capabilities, and continue to operate the CFS in the long run and drive performance.
Sure. That's it from my side. I'll get back to the queue. Thank you.
Thank you. Participants, to ask a question, please press star and one now. The next question is from the line of Chetan Shah from Abacus Asset Management. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thank you for a very detailed explanation at the beginning. Just two quick questions, both to team and Suresh, if they can give us some big picture highlight about the respective regional consolidation process which has gone or which has happened in last 7-8 quarters due to pandemic, where a lot of small regional players have been died out or out of the business due to cash crunch, and how do we see our ability to get that market share going forward, and my second question is there any other opportunity like Speedy Multimode where we can consolidate our positions in CFS business in India? And I have a third question which I'll ask later if I'll be allowed and time permit, please.
Yeah, so I would request Tim to talk about, you know, what has been the competitive landscape like, as you asked about, you know, bigger players gaining advantage over smaller players in consolidation play. And then Suresh can answer your questions around what's happening in India. So over to you, Tim, please.
Yeah, sure. That's a good question, right? We've certainly seen a lot of consolidation over the last 5 years with the ocean freight carriers. And that was out of necessity, actually, because they were not performing very well. So we've seen a lot of consolidation, and just that will actually help answer the previous question as well, which the consolidation of the carrier, there's less carriers. So there's less competition amongst them. So the ocean freights will continue to stay high, just as a supporting comment to that. And then in the freight forwarder community, we've seen a lot of consolidation as well. And it's not just the big companies acquiring large companies. It's small companies. It's also large companies acquiring large companies. And we also are participating in the consolidation of an appetite to grow our market share and presence by the acquisition of Nordicon. So that we fit right into what is happening on the global strategy of acquiring companies. And we will continue to be on the lookout and on the hunt to find and look for new companies that will fit our strategic goals of continual growth in the ocean freight business, both LCL and FCL, as well as now whether we want to grow aggressively in the air freight business. So these three product lines that we're running will continue to be areas where we want to grow, both organically as well as through acquisition, given the right multiple and given the right synergy that we can get out of the targets that we find. I hope that answers that question.
Yeah, thank you, team. If I may just ask one follow-up to that. When you say that we are one of the fully integrated model, both FCL, LCL on ocean and also looking at the air, and we have offices across, and if you look at India business, mainly on a CFS side, and our presence in a various port, that makes us one of the very unique business model on a global platform. May not be in a very larger scale, but on a very significant trade route scale. So could you just explain us that, does this give us any advantage while negotiating with client, not just in terms of pricing, but also in the form of gaining a long-term contractual arrangement with them, which helps us to have a better visibility of the business in a time to come?
So yes, and in the global ocean freight business, we may appear to be small, but in the space in which we operate, we're the number one player. Our competitors are smaller and they're behind us. So on the LCL business in particular, and we're certainly making marks on the FCL. So from a market position perspective, we are in a leadership position on the LCL. I think that answers your question.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Yeah, and Suresh, if you could add about the India part as well.
I'll do that. Thank you. That was a good question. With regard to the opportunities that the present situation throws up, you rightly observed that there are opportunities for consolidation and which come up. And we are constantly on the lookout for strategic fit, where we have great synergies, and we have a very, very strong record of identifying opportunities, taking them on, and then assimilating those or inorganic acquisitions into the group. So that's the strength with which we look at Speedy Multimodes. And given the fact that it is strategically located close to the JNPT port here, helps us to increase our market share in the growing market of Mundra. We felt it's a great opportunity to look at. About your question as to how we responded to the pandemic, and I would like to just add saying that these are very difficult times, dynamic times, and if we are able to respond to the customer's requirements with agility and speed, and that is something that our management and our teams across the country have been able to do. It has been a very difficult period of lockdowns in which there have been many changes which have come, and that's why we have kept our eyes on operations running uninterrupted because we play a vital part in the customer's supply chain and ensuring that there are no disruptions, or even if there are disruptions brought upon by the environment, how can we manage to minimize them? That's something that we have kept an eye on and absorbed some of the shocks. And if I were to kind of tell you, when we went through the first phase of lockdown and there was congestion in the ports, I think we really extended ourselves to ensure that most of our customers who had time critical and those kind of containers, we were able to prioritize and ensure that they didn't have to go through much of disruption. So that is something which we are focused on. And along with that, looking at the opportunities which come up, it's put a lot of pressure on operations, including our own operations. And that's where the quality of the teams that we have in our different facilities comes in handy. We expect to bring that kind of knowledge and understanding of the business as we look at opportunities like Speedy Multimodes, and which is what Ravi was referring to, bring that quality of operations and management to kind of fore to the fore, so that the assimilation of those businesses can happen well.
Yeah. So just one last follow-up on that. The way we acquired Speedy Multimode and trying to put fit into our missing piece, is there any location or area which is like in your top one or two priority, where either inorganic or organic growth, which helps us to make our CFS business much more robust and relatively much more competitive to our competition around us. This is with respect to expected dedicated freight corridor, which is long awaited to get ready, and we are one of the few who can take advantage of that asset once it is ready to take highest advantage out of that.
Yeah, so just to share on that, you know, we have provided this information earlier as well. As far as the CFS business is concerned, we would continue to look at opportunities to grow organically wherever possible without making significant capital commitments. While on the other hand, as far as ICD is concerned, these have to be developed alongside the new dedicated freight corridor, which has brought in paradigm shift in the rail container transport in the country. And we already have an upcoming large multimodal logistics park, which also includes a private freight terminal and ICD coming up at Jhajjar, which would connect with the dedicated freight corridor by way of a special Haryana orbital rail, in which we are also equity partners, holding a very minority strategic stake. And we would continue to look for opportunities to set up facilities in some more additional strategic locations. We cannot share details at this point in time, but yes, we would look at a couple of other facilities along the Western Dedicated Freight Corridor, which would be our focus. And on CFS, we continue to evaluate other opportunities as well, wherever we can find low capital investment, high return kind of opportunities, wherein our capabilities and relationships can play a role in driving growth. We look for such opportunities in some select locations. But there are no significant gaps as such, because the locations we cover already account for almost 80% of the containerized traffic in the country.
Thank you. Thank you, Ravi, for this. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants, to ask a question, please press star and one now. The next question is from the line of Keshav Garg from CCIPL. Please go ahead.
So just wanted to understand that what would be our net debt post these two acquisitions of PD and that Nordic acquisition?
Yeah, so I would request my colleague Deepan to share the details of the debt position with you. Deepal, over to you.
Sure. See, currently our gross group net debt, gross debt or net debt is around 1800 crores across the group, around 1000 crores with All Cargo, around 500 crores for EQ, and around 300 crores at Gati. We have some monetization events, especially the Blackstone event and some of the other events that are lined up. So it would be very difficult to say, but as far as the Nordicon is concerned, that would add marginally around close to 150 to 200 crore debt. But it will be kind of coped up by earnings that we've seen, you know, which are ballooning up and will go up over the rest of the year, and we should be able to kind of repay some of the other loans on that. So we have a target to bring down debt over the next year, by the end of this year. And with both of these acquisitions, we do not see a substantial change in our overall debt positions. But both acquisitions put together, the cost is approximately 200 to 300 crores, which we believe that through higher internal earnings, we should be able to fund that.
So basically, we'll end the year with a similar amount of net debt that we have right now, around 80
crores. Yeah. In fact, if the Blackstone event happens, we should do slightly better than what we're doing now.
Sure. And also, if you could give us any idea about the profitability about that Nordic acquisition, profitability right now, and with our integration and synergies and our superior management, what kind of, how much improvement in operating margins can we extract from that acquisition?
Yeah, so just to share some details on the transaction, there again, it has been an extremely value-accretive transaction for us, wherein we have valued the business on the basis of a 2020 performance, and the business has already grown significantly during the year 2021. And we believe that it will add further synergies to our global network as the cargo will flow into the global network. And in terms of the performance improvement within Nordicon is already run by an excellent management team, very focused on driving growth and digitization. So we believe that the large gains have already been accrued since the negotiation period and the actual performance period at this point in time. So to share with you, we had paid approximately about $29 million for acquiring 65% shareholding in the company, and the company's EBITDA for the calendar year, for the year, along with the additional synergies and contribution to the EBITDA for EQ Worldwide, the total impact should be about $2-3 million impact of an additional EBITDA generated for EQ Worldwide, which would be 100% ours, and the company is expected to do close to about $7 million in EBITDA for the year, and 65% of that would belong to us for the 65% share. So those are the numbers, broadly speaking, and there is no debt in the company. Also, just to highlight the strength of our business, the Nordicon acquisition has been funded from largely from the internal accruals itself. So that speaks volumes about the company's strength in these challenging times as well.
Great, sir. Thank you very much, and best of luck.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Vikram Suryavanshi from Philip Capital. Please go ahead.
Yes, sir. So I just want the clarity on our location, the Jhajjar one, because what I understood, initially we had that warehousing business as well as the ICD business. So the deal with the Blackstone, which are the assets we are holding in Jhajjar, or it is completely sold to Blackstone with 90-10% holding? So if you can give some clarity on Jhajjar asset base.
Yeah, so Jhajjar was being built as a multimodal logistics park, which would have both warehousing and the ICD and PFT business. The company, in fact, so there are two entities which own the land and building there. We are already restructuring those entities by way of a demerger, whereby the business would get segregated into two separate entities, one which would hold all the warehousing assets which are under consideration in the Blackstone transaction, while the second entity will hold the ICD and the PFC business, which is what remains 100% with Allcargo. And it is this ICD-PFC business, which we are referring to when we speak about the ICD at Jhajjar, which is basically near Farooknagar station. And Farooknagar station is now part of the upcoming Haryana Orbital Rail Corridor, which is a high-speed metro come DFC compliant freight transport, which is very unique and provides direct access from Jhajjar to the dedicated freight corridor.
Understood. And how much CapEx will do for development of this ICD and PFT, and over how many, basically how we are looking at it will start in a time frame?
So I would say that there are currently certain ongoing approvals and some land parcels being acquired for the purpose of railway track to be laid, and which would happen during this financial year. However, subsequent investments of procuring additional land and building up the freight terminal would largely be in the subsequent financial year. And in terms of the exact scale and size, it is still a bit of a broad range. So we would share details in the coming quarters as we are still contemplating the exact operational and business plan based on traffic studies and competitive landscape. So we would share numbers when we are more closer to having the final figures for the same.
Okay. And this 1,000 crore debt, what we have in standalone, how much of that can will go once Blackstone deal will be complete?
Yeah, Deepal, if you could answer that, please.
Okay, so just so further clarify, the total debt, net debt for Allcargo India, I mean, standalone is around 1,000 crores. And net debt across the group is 1,400 crores, not 1,800 crores. 1,800 crores is the gross debt. So 1,000 crore, we expect this to go down by around 300 odd crores by end of the year if the Blackstone deal goes through.
Understood. And And my last question about this, basically, if you look at Alcargo, has advantage of network as well as the kind of investment what we have done in technology. And we were talking about really capitalizing that for end-to-end delivery model. So how much we have been able to move to end-to-end delivery model, and how what kind of growth and profitability impact it can have going ahead? So if you can comment on that, I think that will be helpful.
So there are three parts to it. One is an integrated freight offering. Second is your customer-facing synergies. And third is back-end synergies. As far as integrated freight offerings are concerned, today we have Gati service capabilities fitting right in the EQ360, the global digital platform, which allows for end-to-end road transportation. And while it is still a small base, it is steadily picking up. And our focus as a business at EQ Worldwide is also to expand on the digital and door-to-door offerings. So in that regard, it's a great capability, which is gaining the in percentage. On the other side, our ability to offer integrated freight services also picking up with various other initiatives such as CFS and Gati coming together, as well as offering end-to-end products for cross-border e-commerce, etc. However, it's a small base, not making a significant commercial impact on the overall scale of business. The other two synergies are actually playing a more critical role. One, on the customer facing, wherein customers now recognize Alcargo as a service provider, which can be a true logistics partner to take care of all their requirements. And therefore, there's a greater interest in working with Alcargo across the business segments. And that is something which is certainly helping us drive significant growth in revenue through both acquisition of new customers, as well as expanding the share of wallet with the existing customers. And that's something which is visible in the growth patterns of Gati over the last few quarters. And the third point, which has also been significantly worked upon, is the back-end synergies, whereby by having businesses across the group which integrate across the value chain, we are in a position to synergize procurement and support operations, which have helped us to maintain the highest quality standards while optimizing costs. And optimizing costs certainly helps improve the profit margins as well. So this is what has been happening on the, you know, the overall synergies on integration, customer relationship, and on the back end.
Got it, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Prateek Kumar from Antique Stock Broking. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the follow-up opportunity. Just one thing on debt. We said net debt is 1,400 crore and around 200 crore will be added by the Nauticon acquisition. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And just one thing on this logistic park construction for Blackstone and other parties. This has been quite delayed generally in terms of construction. So if we just want to put that on a scale of construction in terms of percentage, so how should we understand that? Because still it seems March 22 also is not a very confirmative target we are looking at. So
let me just clarify there. There is no delay absolutely on construction or operations whatsoever. In fact, the facilities are already constructed and operational and also revenue accretive, and we have also in some of the SPVs even raised LRD funding, which is discounting the lease rate. So as you would see from the segmental reporting, the facilities are already starting to earn revenues, and which is increasing quarter on quarter as new tenants are moving in. The delays that we are attributing to are some of the conditions precedent to be fulfilled, which are around some very small land parcels, which had some technical changes and some technical approvals which are pending with the government authorities, which are still pending because the functioning of the government authorities in the state of Karnataka as well as Haryana has been constrained by the COVID pandemic. It does not impact the operational aspect of the logistics park, which continue to work well on both the construction as well as leasing out. So there are no concerns on the operational front. It's just that some conditions precedent which were linked with the government approvals have been delayed. and therefore the consummation of Blackstone transaction has been delayed, but it does not have any impact on the operational or the constructional aspects of the logistics parks.
Ravi, this is Deepal. To add furthermore, through the year, there will be many other boxes which will be completed and LRDs raised. So there are no issues on the construction for sure.
But we are still not very confirmed on receipt of the remaining money.
No, so we are very confident of finishing it. But as you are aware that we are right amidst the pandemic, functioning of some of the offices at the government and they're not in within our control. So we are not able to decide.
Okay, thanks for clarification. I'll get back to the
question. It wouldn't be fair to give a timeline with some things which we don't have a control on.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Chetan Shah from Abacus Asset Management. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Just one small question. What will be the normal capex for the current financial year, apart from these two acquisitions which you did?
Yeah, Deepal, if you could answer that on the capex budget.
Yeah, so we do not have any. So if we leave the Blackstone and pieces, you know, where the construction needs to be completed, if we leave that aside, apart from that, we do not have any other large capexes other than just maintenance capex through the year. That's a very, very small amount.
Just to add further on that, you know, most of the expenses have been have been moved into operating expense category as we look at, you know, using technology also through service providers as a service rather than investing. The focus has been very sharp on keeping the capex minimal. So therefore, in proportion to the earnings, it will be very minimal.
Got it. Thanks. Thanks a lot.
Yeah.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, this was the last question for today. I would now like to hand the conference over to Mr. Vikram Suryavanshi for closing comments.
Thank you, Rutuja. We thank the management of Alcargo Logistics for giving us an opportunity to host the call and taking time out for interaction with the stakeholder. Thank you all for being on the call.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. It was a pleasure to be here.
Yeah.
Thank you, Sarya.
Thank you everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. On behalf of Phillip Capital India Private Limited, that concludes the conference call. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your line.